evening. Good evening. To God be the glory. So those of you that may be worshiping with us in our Bible study on this Wednesday night, I want to say good evening to you too, as well in virtual. To God be the glory. What another awesome day God has allowed us to see. Amen. I am Deacon Gregory, and I will be facilitating our Bible study on tonight. So those of you that's in virtual, text, call a friend, and let them know that New Hope is on the air again. Amen. So to God be the glory. I'm looking forward to dialoguing with my members that's here in the sanctuary. And we'll be coming out of Acts chapter 16. And the verses we're going to try to cover tonight is 16 through 40. Again, that's Acts 16. And we'll be covering, covering verses 16 through 40. Amen? Let us pray. Father God, we come again thanking you, God, for who you are. Father God, thank you because we know we live, move, we have our being. It's all because of you, and it's through you. Thank you, God, for allowing us to see yet another day. We thank you, God, for the ability to get ourselves out of our place of our home, get into our vehicles, God, and get here safe. And just to study your word, we ask you to bless those that's in virtual, whether they're in their homes, in their vehicles, whatever, that they're safe. And we look forward to you allowing us to decrease in this moment, God, that you may increase and that you may give us a word that will cause us to go, to give us that energy, or give us that effort to go on another day. We thank you, God, for our pastor, for his family. We thank you for the New Hope family. We thank you, God, for just the awesome God that you are. So, God, we're going to yield now. Allow me to decrease, God. Have your way that you may increase, that we may get every word that you have designed for us to get on tonight. It is in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. Amen. And again, good evening. It's good to see you. I'm a little nervous right now, but that's okay. That's probably my nature. But I know my brothers and sisters in the house, so I know you guys got my back. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to facilitate a lesson, and God has a word for us on tonight. So I'm hoping that when I'm done sharing God's word with you through the Bible, and I'm hoping that you will get the word that God has for you today. And that's for you, not just here in the sanctuary, but those of you that's in virtual. Amen? So let us get into God's word. So the title for Acts 16, verses 16 through 40, I'm going to use the title, What Must I Do to Be Saved? And as a subtitle, The Jailhouse Rock. Amen. So hopefully by the end of tonight, we're all going to know what, and we're Christians, we should already know what we must do to be saved, and how a jailhouse rock saved a whole family. Amen. So let's go. So let me give you some background. Back in 1957, Elvis Presley put out a song titled Jailhouse Rock. It went something like this. The warden threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there, and they began to wail. The band was jumping, and the joint began to swing. You should have heard them knock out Jailbird Sing. Long before that, around 50 A.D., God allowed Paul and Silas to perform God's version of a jailhouse rock. Amen. So that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Jailhouse rock. Amen. So let me, our characters for our lesson tonight, and some scripture that we can meditate on. It says, suggested emphasis, in Christ we can experience true joy despite our circumstances. As brothers and sisters, and we know that even regardless of our circumstances, we know as a Christian what? We can still experience joy in the midst of trouble. In the midst of whatever trouble that we all have, at sometimes in our lives, we're all going to have some trouble come our way. But as Christians, we all understand that even in those situations, circumstances, we still what? We still can find joy in the midst of that. Our memory verse, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. That's Philippians 4:4. Mm-hmm. Our morning manna has been all about praising God for the last month or so. Mm-hmm. So I was trying to tie this to what we've been studying all the time, you know, praise the Lord. We should always, as Christians, we should always find a reason to do what? To praise the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. That's scripture, right? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Everything that have breath, what? Praise the Lord. So hopefully we all have a spirit of praising the Lord. And that's what our this lesson is about. Yeah. So here are our characters for tonight. The first character is Paul. Paul identifies himself as an Orthodox Jewish Pharisee mm-hmm. and the son of a Pharisee who was born a citizen of Rome. Mm-hmm. Paul, an apostle previously called Saul, we know the story by Saul, was not one of the 12 apostles. Matter of fact, I believe this was Paul, depending on, look at the commentary, I believe this is either his second or first or second missionary trip that he was on. I think this was the first time he actually, this was very close to after he had that experience on Damascus, and he's going out and as a missionary preaching God's word. Yeah. So he's kind of young in his ministry at this point. Yeah. Amen? And my brothers and sisters, if I'm wrong, you need to say, hey, Ding Greg, that's not right.
No, you're right, because this first mission was out there was Paul and Barnabas.
Right.
And now you see it's Paul and Silas.
My point is, you know, I don't want to lead nobody. It's never my intention to lead anybody wrong from God's word. But I am human. I am subject to error. If you don't believe me, ask my wife. Amen. So my brothers and sisters, y'all need to keep Dick and Gregory straight. Amen. So our other character, Silas. He was an early Christian prophet and a missionary. What Dick and O'Brien just said, he was a companion of Paul. The slave girl, the fortune teller. I found over 100 scriptures that address fortune tellers. Mm-hmm. And there may be more, but I didn't read all of them, but it's like over 100 scriptures that talked about that. Exodus 22:18 says, you shall not permit a sorceress to live. I'm just going to leave that like so. So the word is very strict about fortune tellers and sorcerers. It says, shouldn't even let them live. Now, that could be figuratively, but the word says, if you're not a Christian, if you're not a born again person, you are part of the walking dead.
Yes.
Now, that's when I read the Bible, if you're not a Christian, then I don't think I'm wrong. Somebody correct me again. If you're not a Christian, you might be living and breathing every day, but guess what? You're the walking dead. Because maybe you don't know, but the Bible tells us where you're going when you die. I don't know about you, Sister Sheila. I'm not going to live to die. I'll live a dying life to die again. That makes no sense to me. I'm going to live this life to live eternally. What must I do to be saved? To me, that's plain and simple. We're going to get to that, all right? I don't know about you, but my nervousness is going away. I'm starting to have fun now. To God be the glory. All right, so we're talking about a slave girl, and now the Philippian jailer had been put in a position that his very life was on the line for ensuring that the prisoners, Paul and Silas, stay put. Man, he was like in an almost lose-lose situation. Mm-hmm. Anyway, but we'll get to that. Mm-hmm. But those were the characters. However, there's one more character. There's one more. The Most High God was there too. Yeah. Jesus, God the Father and God the Son was there. As Christians, we know if no matter what's going on, no matter what it looks like, I don't want to talk about our election yesterday. I don't care who won. At the end of the day, God is still in control.
Amen.
He's still in charge. So I'm good. And as Christians, we all should be good because we should know who is really in control. Amen? So let's go. I hope you're ready for the ride. I know I am. So here we go. Paul and Silas in prison. Now, it happened as we went to prayer that a certain slave girl possessed with a spirit of divination met us, who bought her masters much profit by fortune telling. Divination, that is the practice of determining the hidden significance or cause of events. Now we're going to find out that she spoke some truth, but she spoke it in mocking who God was.
Yeah.
That's a problem. Yeah. What she said, we'll find out in a second, it wasn't a lie.
Yeah.
But she was mocking.
Yeah, she was operating in a different spirit.
She was operating in a different spirit. So my brothers and sisters, you know, we can say something. Mm-hmm. We can say we love God, love Jesus. That's just lip service. What's the fruit behind saying that? Remember that, may the works I do speak for me?
Speak for
behind, we can have faith, but faith without works is what? Is that's not Dean Gregory saying, that's biblical. We can have faith in him, but you got to do some works. Faith without works is dead. She said, what she said was right. I'm going to get to it in a second. But she was mocking God. That's not good. And I think, let me read that again. It says that her, let me get to slave girl. Oh, who bought her master's much profit for fortune telling. Man, them jokers about to get upset.
Yeah.
They making money off of what she could do.
That's the other player.
They are using this young lady, her gift in a negative way. Why? Because they're trying to make money off of what she do. That sounds a little bit like America right about now. I'm going to leave that alone. I'm going to leave that alone. Be careful. Yes, brother. Yes. Hold on. I'm going to bring a mic to you, Brother Roberts.
No, I just want to know where we're at.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're in Acts 16. Thank you. We're in Acts 16, verse 16.
Okay.
You're quite welcome. Sorry about that, Brother Roberts. Sister Roberts, it's good to see y'all. All right. So, verse 17. This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, "These men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation." Can someone real quickly, I need someone to go to Mark 1:24. Again, so I need someone to go to Mark chapter 1, verse 24. I'm going to read 17 again. It says, "This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, 'These men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation.'" Anybody got to Mark 1:24 yet? Can you read it real quick? Yeah, hold on. He's got you.
Okay, Mark
1:24.
I know I was just there. I'm sorry. Mark. I was just there. I know. Okay, Mark 1:24. Okay, Mark 1:24 says, "Saying, 'Let us alone, what we to do with thee, though Jesus of Nazareth art thou come to destroy us? I know thee, who thou art, the Holy One of God."
Amen.
Amen.
Well, this gonna be good.
They know him, but guess what they didn't have? They had no relationship with him. There's a lot of people out there that know him, but they have no connection or relationship to him. Oh, I'm sorry, not know of him. Let me correct my, that's right, know of him. But they don't know him for the pardon of their sins.
See, because I always say, look at scripture and find out who's doing the talking.
Right.
That was the evil one talking. And you remember, he was in that was the evil spirit that was in the person.
Mm-hmm.
And he asked him that question there. And same thing with the young lady who was on the fortune teller.
Right.
She had an evil spirit in her. But they recognized who Jesus was.
Exactly. But had no connection.
No connection.
Knowledge about who God is is not faith in him. There are a lot of people who have knowledge of him, but they have no faith in him. What must I do to be saved? Amen. That's a profound question that every human being at some point in their life should ask themselves. What must I do to be saved? Think about all the questions you can come up with. That one right there is the most profound question we could ever ask. Because that one comes with assurance that I come that you may have life, you may have it more abundantly. I come that you may have eternal life. That one says that this is not my home. Heaven is my home. So I'm just a pilgrim on a journey passing through. And understand and realize that this is only temporary. And I got to do what I need to do now temporary so I can get to my eternal home. So it should be easy for us to do what? Spell heaven, H-O-M-E, instead of H-E-A-V-N. We're trying to get home. Not now, Lord, not right now. But that's the path that we want should be walking, right? So we're down to verse number 17. The girl fall upon, oh, I just read 17. We're in 18. And this she did for many days. But Paul, greatly annoyed, Paul is annoyed now, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus to come out of her. And he came out that very hour. Paul didn't say, I command thee in the name of Paul to come out. He said, what? In the name of Jesus. Now, if God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, so if he gave Paul that authority and that power to speak to a demon back then, why we can't, shouldn't we have the same power and authority today? So we got to understand and realize we have that same power and authority to speak to situations in our lives. Mm-hmm. We can rebuke things that's not right in our lives. We can embrace ourselves and pray and speak over ourselves. It's okay to call a pastor deacon, mm-hmm. but we can. We say we're Christians. We say we're born again. We can do that on our own. Mm-hmm. The word, we have the authority and power to do that in the name of Jesus. And sometimes you may not have time to get that in the name Jesus. He hears you. Yes. And like Pastor said the other Sunday, I think it was, you don't have to keep telling him the same thing over and over. He heard you the first time. He heard us the first time. He doesn't move in our time. He moves in one in his time. I can only speak for Dean Gregory, Sister Robert. Sometimes God got to take me the long route. Because I don't get it, because I'm hard-headed. I'm stubborn sometimes. So sometimes you got it. Your mom told you, hey, don't go there and touch that stove. It's hot. I heard what mama said, but guess what Dean Gray going to do? I'm going to go over there. Ouch. I'm not the only one. Some of us like that too. But what I'm saying is that's... I'm going to recover from it. I mean, that's not going through my mind. My point is this. We all are different. Yes. And I know how I'm a very physical type person. That's how I see things. Mm-hmm. I got to touch things and feel things. I'm just saying, I'm not going to be touching. I'm not going to be. But my point is, I'm a visual type person. Mm-hmm. I heard what my mom said. But don't we serve an awesome God? Yeah. That he keeps us through all that stuff, that stuff. And we all have our gifts and our talents, and he know that about us. Mm-hmm. He already know all that stuff about us. All right? And that's why, you know, my wife and I, we've been married for how many years now, baby? 30? Somebody give her a mic. 38,
baby.
That's what I said, was it? Did I say 38? So my
don't leave him out there. Help him.
Lord, man. Help him. My wife just left me hanging. She couldn't.
No, you'll make me laugh.
But my point is, we are different in a lot of ways. Uh-huh. A lot of ways. But we have learned how to coexist, and every day gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. I'm being a little transparent right now. I mean, you know, my wife, she's like, ain't no, uh-uh. I'm like, yeah, we are. Yeah. but to God be the glory. God knows that about every last one of us, just like in the story right now. You know, he knows what how we are, what we desire, what we need, and how we react to situations. He already know that about us. Yeah, because he is our creator. He made us. So the story goes on. I'm in verse 19, I believe, right? It says, but when her master saw that their hope of profit was gone, so now the master, again, they think about that, all that. Did I think, you think they're really thinking about that slave girl that's got the demon possessed? All they thinking about what? Is their profit, their money, how she's gonna bring them money. It says, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. And they brought them to the marketplace and said, these men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city. Mm-hmm. Now, hold on. It says, exceedingly trouble our city.
How can this one master speak for everybody? They must have had a meeting, and he got that thumbs up from everybody, because he said our city, which means he's saying that everybody feel the way they feel. That's one of the things that get us messed up sometimes. I'm an educator. I get so upset when my students come to my classroom, those of you in virtual too, and they say to me, well, that's what my other teacher, that's what they, I'm not, my name is not other teacher. Oh, that's what everybody else let me get away with it. My name is not let you get away with it. I'm Mr. Gregory. This is 838. Learn the rules in here. Let's live. I don't call them rules anymore. I try to call them expectations to make them feel a little bit better, but it rules. We have established an expectation in this classroom. Don't call me other teacher. My name is Mr. Gregory.
So I noticed that those that are not within the spirit have the power of speaking a language that those that don't have faith can. So that's why in that town, it just took one man to speak for everyone outside of others knowing themselves what the truth really was.
I want to make sure I understand. You said it's associated with a language that they were speaking?
Like in the sense that what you were just saying, that those... To have knowledge of Jesus is one thing, although having faith is something else. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I notice that people may not have knowledge of much of anything, but because they can speak a certain way or say something, people will be consumed by that.
Absolutely. Well,
there was her conversation leads to the point to money, because what? Their money source was cut off.
Right.
And so the people he was talking to in the marketplace, that's a place of business.
Oh yeah.
So right now he was talking. Well,
they were part of their money source. Right. Yes. Yes. You're absolutely right about that. But that's why. Well, we, as Christians, we got to know God for ourselves. We can't. You know, I can't live off of my mother and my dad and my grandparents. Their faith and their walk with God. This is an individual, personal thing. I thank God for my parents and my grandparents and any of my in-laws, even my brothers, that helped to shape and mold me. But this is, when it comes to that kind of, that's on us. You know, God ain't gonna look at me and I'm saying, well, hey, grandma, mama, they made it in. Hey, I'm good, right? Uh-uh. You got to work out your own soul salvation. That's an individual thing. And that's why we got to be careful about the world, because the world can mess us up. I mean, we know that the world, and that's why we can get up. We can, wherever we are, when those kind of situations come up in our lives, we can pray about it. Yeah. God, I need understanding. I need here for you to make sense out of this. It doesn't make sense to me. I'm not going to follow you just because you have a position or whatever. No, I need to check in with God. I need to make sure that what you said or whatever I need to do, it's of the word. And we have the power and authority. I mean, we all should. I mean, at the end of the day, we should stand on the word.
Yes.
And the Bible is clear on heaven and earth will pass away. Only what? His word going to stand. So we got to stand on God's word. And we got to know it for ourselves.
There's also a power structure in place here. I mean, men... had the ability, none at all. Men were allowed to speak up about things that women were not allowed to speak up against. And, I mean, she was a slave, so they could pretty much do whatever they wanted to do where Amen. She was concerned.
That is correct. Now, what I didn't say, I did some research on this, and that scripture, it says, here's a note for us. It was no crime under Roman law to exorcise a demon or to heal a mentally sick person. Mm. It wasn't even a crime. But they charged them of it. Back then, it wasn't a crime for them to say, rebuke the spirit and told that spirit to come out. That wasn't a crime. But the magistrate punished them for it.
They didn't say he was a Roman citizen. They say Paul and Silas, these Jews, they was foreigners in that land.
Amen.
And until
and later Paul on, was definitely not a Jew.
No. But it's later on in it. I don't want to get too fast and too far.
That's why I said that. That it took someone speaking of something that they were not, and all everyone did was be consumed and ran with it instead of knowing something
And that's what's happening in our world. What you just said is happening in our world right today. Facebook and all these other platforms are literally consuming people's time. And they're all doing is putting out false information. They hear it, and guess what? People do what? They run with it. There's a lot of praying needs to happen for Christians. Yes. If my people will call my name, will seek my face, will pray, turn away from their wicked ways, and God says, I will heal the land.
Heal the land.
Heal the land. Amen. That means we still got work to do. We need to break that fever. And we don't have to be, we need to be prayer warriors. And we need to break that fever that's in the country right now, because there's a fever in the country right now. Amen? Verse 21 says, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe. Then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such charge, he put them in the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. And doing some research, they said that the prisons back then, they had three compartments. The inner, I guess the middle inner, then the inner. They call it the dungeon. And when they put you in there, they put you in the dungeon because they expect you to stay in the dungeon until you die. Not only did they chain, they actually put them, they said in stock, they chained them to the floor. Well, they had very limited movement in that dungeon. So you go from speaking a word on God's behalf, healing, actually doing good works, healing a person, and now you find yourself in shackles in prison. And the jailer, imagine how you feel right now, because they told him, they commanded him, let me go on. It said, having received such a charge to put them into the inner prison and fasten their stock. Let me go on. The jailer saved. I'm sorry. Let me go back. Let me go back real quick. There was a piece that I want to talk about, and they went to lay the stripes through them. Commanded the jailer. That's verse 23 in Acts 16:23. It says, he commanded the jailer to keep them secure. That jailer was in a tough, difficult situation. If those prisons were to break out, he was going to surely die. They actually command and told him, you're responsible for these prisoners. If they escape, or if they are not there when we want them, then you're going to surely die. So that was a burden on the jailer himself. And it goes on saying, now I'm in verse 25, but, there's that but. At midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Now, I got a problem right there. Well, first of all, I'm on the end part. It says the prisoners were listening to them. If I'm confined in a jail, and I'm not a Christian, instead of when I start praying our songs, shut up! I'm trying to sleep! Come on now. They in jail. Think about what I just said. Nobody complained.
No. I just wish they said which song he was singing. Because it's
nobody
midnight.
Complained. They said that they were listening, they were praying, and they were listening to what they were doing.
Yeah. What pray? What song? My goodness.
And the first part that says, it says, at midnight. Now, all of us have had midnight experiences. And all of us know midnight is not always at 12 p.m. or a.m., however you want to look at that. You can have a midnight experience in the middle of the day.
Yes.
Them dark days. But what's so beautiful about that midnight experience is what? You know help is on the way. If I can make it to midnight or whatever, that's another day. And God says brand new mercies we see daily. A new day. And even if you don't get me through the midnight, my midnight experience, I still know he's God. And he's God Almighty. It wasn't designed for me to make it through the midnight. But to know that whatever our midnight experience will be or shall be or can be, he's right there with us. And our midnight experiences, brand new mercies we see daily. Amen. That is an awesome God. Again, that's not just physically midnight. Like I said, your midnight could be in the middle of the day, could be in the morning, evening, whatever. And we all have midnight experiences.
Can you back up for a second? Because that's right after the many stripes. I like the NIV says severely flawed.
Okay.
So they got beat real bad. Real
bad. Amen.
It ain't like there was like one or two. They Amen. Beat them real bad. And they still singing. And you know what? Them prisoners that was along with him, they knew that.
Amen.
And he's still singing and praying. I always ask myself when I read scripture, what was the song, Lord?
They were singing.
Yeah, and what was the prayer? Because it was no shouting. I like what you say, because they said they were listening. And so they were preaching in bars, behind the bars.
Amen. Amen. They were. And I'm sure that in their mind, those prisoners, they were like, well, these men have, like I said, they've been frogged. They've been, if they're stripes, they're bleeding.
Yeah.
All these things are going on, but they have looked beyond that physical pain. Yay. And now they're in a spiritual realm where they actually can go beyond that. And they're praising their God.
That's a teaching moment for us.
So we all have that inner, you can call it inner strength or whatever. Sometimes remember that flesh gets weak? But if we get into that spiritual realm, we can push ourselves through those fleshly weaknesses we have in our lives sometimes. Amen? We can. I didn't tell my wife this, and Sturgis didn't know. I wasn't feeling well Saturday at all. I worked, Saturday. I went to school, and I was nervous. I prayed about it. When I went to school, I did some work. And when I started moving the building, I started moving slow. I'm like, I don't feel well. I said, Lord, cover me. I didn't tell my wife. She didn't know. I just kept praying. When I got here, I was walking slow. I wasn't feeling well at all for that meeting. But to God be the glory, I kept praying, cover me, Lord. And he did. He kept me.
Amen.
I can't tell you what was going on. It just, I wasn't, I, it was like I was just, and I'm not, a, anybody know, I don't walk slow. I walk with the, I'm walking when I walk. I'm not a slow walker. I never experienced that before in my life. And I thank God for who he is. I just kept praying, God, I need you to keep me, cover me. Not my will, but your will be done in my life right now. And he kept me. And I went home, and I just kind of chilled a little bit. She probably didn't know why, but I was chilling because I wasn't feeling well. But we all have situations like that sometimes. The Spirit reveals all things, right? Yeah, I know. So, but my point is, I mean, that's an awesome God that we serve. You know, we all have assignments, and God will prepare us for the assignments that he have laid before us. I think we should all know that.
That's right.
I mean, he didn't save us just to be pew setters. He saved us so we can go out in the vineyards and what?
On,
and enlarge, increase the kingdom.
Yeah,
that's a directive. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We're kingdom builders, right?
Amen.
And we don't always got to say something. It's just how we present ourselves to people. You don't always got to say something to people. It's how you present yourself. Woo, exactly. Well, Paul and Silas, that's what they're doing right there in the Word.
Right.
I was going to say, isn't that a wonderful thing to just be around somebody that's a Christian? Because a lot of folks getting ready to be blessed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't getting ready to be blessed. It's a good thing to be around Christians sometimes. Because when the blessings come, man, overflow. Amen. So that's, amen, we're getting there, but because of Paul and Silas, some people about to get blessed. So where are we? I think we're in verse 26. Yep, there we go. Suddenly, oh God, suddenly. Woo! Suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundation of the prison was shaken. And immediately, suddenly and immediately, all the doors were open and everyone's chains were loosed. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Suddenly and immediately, earthquake, shaken. Now, when things are shaking, if they're in an inner compartment of that, things should be falling all around. And I ain't said nothing, but they were ducking and dodging, nothing. No. And all the chains was what? Loose. Because God has set us free. We've been set free, so why we allow any chains to keep us in bound? We are free. So we got to get the heart right, that mind right. Because believe it or not, there are a lot of people that are in prison right now are more free than people walking around every day.
Amen. Come on. Come on.
And we got to understand that thing. We talked about it earlier by walking dead. There's a lot of people that in our prison that walk by us every day, and they're nothing but the living dead. They have no salvation in them. They desire to have none. Suddenly, I got to read that again. It says, suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundation of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were open and everyone's chains were loose. No matter what the situation looks like. There's a scripture that says, on Christ the solid rock I stand. That's a foundation we all should be standing on, right? Yes. There could be chaos all around us. We don't even see our way out of it. But if we stand on Christ the solid rock, we got an assurance, insurance to know what? That he's going to keep us. Because he is a keeper.
Yes, he is.
He's a healer. He's a provider. He knows exactly what we need, when we need it, all that good stuff. He doesn't answer us in our time. He answers us in what? In his time. And if there's ever a foundation that we need to stand on, it's Christ the solid rock we should stand on. That's the foundation that we should be standing on. Amen. As Christians. That's a daily 24/7 thing. Yes.
Thank you. So, I know I say this in a few different ways at other times, but I just want us to be clear about what happens here. Because you say that the people in the jail got blessed, and I just want to pinpoint it a little further and say that they were freed.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. Paul and Silas were the ones praising God.
But
the people in the jail who were only listening were free. Sometimes... some people's deliverance depends on your praise.
Pray. Oh, hallelujah.
Now,
you got to say that one more time. Hold on. No, we got to say that.
She got to say that one more time because it was one more scripture that's behind that.
You got to say that again.
It's one more scripture. Say that again.
Sometimes,
some people's deliverance
is
depends upon your praise.
Now, his scripture, you remember when they ripped the roof off the house and the man was paralytic was on the mat?
Right.
Never said a word. Matter of fact, the four that was lowering him down never said a word. Jesus was the one to respond and says, he saw their faith lowering them, that guy down, and he got healed.
Right. So when we come on Sunday morning and we want to sit on our bench and I don't know what we're doing, you know, twiddling our thumbs, whatever it is we're doing, when we come here on Sunday morning, we have an assignment. We have a job. We come here to give him glory. We come here to give him a praise. And
hallelujah, wife.
Very likely, in fact, by this explanation and example, somebody can get freed if we'll just do
come on
what we're
now.
Supposed to do.
We got to understand this thing, Christian. We are sometimes maybe blocking somebody's breakthrough because we won't give praise. That's why when I sit on that front pew right there, I ask myself, am I a barrier blocking or am I, it's coming through me and hitting somebody else? We got to ask ourselves, am I blocking what pastors say or am I taking it in and shooting out to somebody else? As Christians, we got to be mindful of that thing. And we just talk about our meeting, guys. Even ministers, we know that, pastors know that. When we're doing this stuff is like surgery sometimes. We're dealing with people's mind and their heart. We got to understand that thing.
When we do an altar call, when the altar call begins, I'll stand in the back. And many times, I'll begin to praise God. Because I'm praising God for the person that was like me, sitting here, that tug on your heart,
right.
But you're embarrassed. You, your friends, people are sitting around, but you got that tug in your heart. I'm interceding, not saying that I'm interceding, I'm going through that motion saying, God, please lift the heavy burden. Please inspire them.
Exactly.
Please heal the brokenhearted.
Yes.
Bring the wayward Christian
yes.
back. Bring the backslide.
Yes.
That is my prayer.
Hallelujah.
So when I see somebody stand up to come up here, it hit different for me. It hit a little bit different. And I'm not trying to be funny and say I'm this or that, but it hit different for me because
right.
I start praying. As soon as he get up Amen. Here and start doing an altar call, I immediately go into a prayer. I don't get up and turn the
Amen.
Pew around.
But here's
yeah.
what they're really saying.
Yeah.
They're saying they're being led by the Spirit. That's what they're really saying. That they're connected to the source. And when the Spirit, when that happens, the Spirit tells them, I need to do something. And it tells them exactly what they're supposed to do. And guess what? They're being obedient and they're doing it. Oh,
and
glory. Let's,
okay.
let's have a Bible study.
And that's why when I first started coming to this church, I wasn't afraid to tell my testimony.
Amen.
To be a complete stranger, not Amen. Knowing a soul in Hampton, Virginia. Coming here with my kids Sundays and Wednesdays. I share these sermons with my friends. I'm sending messages to people at my job.
Amen.
I'm keeping them open to think that if you serve God, look at me.
Amen.
I'm
Hallelujah.
Just like you.
God, look at Hallelujah. Amen. Yesterday, during voting, I was at work at Kickatan, and when I pulled out the parking lot, I saw those people, the people that you know, hand you stuff when you go into the voting booth or whatever. And the Spirit just said, give them water. I'm like, I ain't giving no water. I went to 7-Eleven, and I was like, I don't want to go back to Kickatan. And I got 6 bottles of water. I took it back to him and said, I just want to give you a bottle of water. Yeah, it took me out of my way, but the point is, I don't know. Sometimes we just got to be obedient to the Spirit and do what the Spirit tells us to do. I ain't nothing. I said, be safe out here. I gave him a bottle of water, and I went my way. And I felt good about it because the Spirit led me to do that.
That's right.
We don't know what people are going through. That what I said, that could have broke something in their lives and opened it up. Man, things are not as bad as I think they are, whatever.
It takes a relationship. It takes a relationship. And then you being sensitive to the Spirit because you know God when you're speaking to him.
Right.
You know that was him.
Amen.
You're being obedient, but it's a relationship with him.
It is. Amen. Amen.
Man, I just want to piggyback on what my brother said.
I know intercessory prayer. I know that's your big thing. Go ahead, babe. Go ahead. Tell it.
I'm getting ready to tell it.
Tell it.
And I'm going to tell it in a couple of weeks, amen. But when that altar call comes, man, that is a serious time in our service.
When
pastor calls for those who are,
warfare,
you know, who want to know Christ, it is a very serious time. We just really got to start taking it a lot more seriously.
Amen.
That's right.
And be
Amen.
Focused in on, because you know there are unsaved people among us. They are.
Amen.
And we need to be praying that it is to me, it's the most important part of the service.
Yeah, it is.
Hallelujah.
And we just have to be more mindful and more
and sensitive
intentional
about it.
And not looking around to see who's coming. but praying for those who you expect to come. Amen. And wait for God to
Amen.
Bless.
Amen.
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 Coming.
Amen.
I got my traction.
I see. Yes, I'm going back to what you were saying, Deacon Gregory, about when you was handing the people the water.
Right.
You know, sometimes God will test us to see where our hearts are. So if you are Christian and you're a child of God, like,
Amen.
You're supposed to always give, because God gonna always, he gonna test you to see what your faith Amen. Is, to see how much love you have in your heart as
Amen.
A Christian.
Amen.
If a person, say if a person walk up to you and say they hungry, and if that's the spirit tells you to go get them something to eat, it's being
be obedient
and do what the spirit says does.
Hallelujah.
Because today, Amen. We was in a place today, and I didn't know this person from a can of paint, and it's the God I have a truth. And he was like, I need a dollar. I ain't turned no word. I said, Lord, I got the dollar. I'm going to give, because I'm going to tell you something. God has blessed me and my husband, and I know.
Amen.
He's a good God. He's an on-time God.
Amen.
And
that's right.
Gregory, you know what our blessing was, and I'm so grateful I was able to give that dollar, because when you give, you get it back tenfold. That's what
Amen.
God said. You
to
get
God
it back.
Be the glory.
So you have to learn to give when Amen. You got it to give.
Amen. And as Christians, we know God blesses us. Why? To be a blessing. That's why he blessed us. He ain't blessed us with a set on our blessings. He blesses us to be a blessing to someone else. And what? And look what God will do. He's an awesome God. I mean, Pat's talking about, I got it. Unfailing resources. Oh, glory, that's glory time. He talked about it last Wednesday. He has unfailing resources. Deke, like 2 weeks ago, I wasn't going to say nothing, but until you just said unfailing resource, it made me tell this testimony. 2 weeks ago, I was coming from North Carolina. I stopped to get gas at this random gas station, just random. Mm-hmm. One plan, just stopped to get gas. And I had this black T-shirt on that says Grace across the front of it. I went in, paid for my gas. I came back out. I wasn't even, and I'm going to be honest, y'all know me, I wasn't even singing a gospel song. I was singing a song by a group called Jodeci, an R&B song, walking back to my car. This man.
Pastor didn't hear that, did he?
Yeah, man. I'm going to tell the truth. He know me. So, hey, I wasn't even singing a gospel song. I was singing a worldly song. And the guy at the pump, him and his wife was in a moving van, big moving van. He said, man, you got a nice voice. I said, man, I appreciate you, bro. And I turned around, and he said, oh, man, I like that shirt. That's Grace. We all need that. And I said, man, sure, man. I said, you moving? He said, yeah, I'm from Virginia. I said, I'm from Virginia. He said, I'm from Suffolk. I said, I'm from Newport News. He said, what church you go to? I said, New Hope Baptist Church. He said, oh, wow, I go to such and such Baptist church. I'm an associate minister there. I said, and I was kind of embarrassed to say this part. I said, wow, I'm an associate minister there too. And you coming out here? And he said, anyway, I said, man, I got to preach next Sunday at this church. Amen. In Tabernacle, come to find, I'm going to tell you how God moved, y'all. And I can't, this is no fluff or nothing. I took my shirt off. He kept talking about my shirt.
Uh-huh.
And y'all know how bold I am. I took my shirt off in the middle, and it was kind of one of the cold, kind of chilly days. Took my T-shirt off. He's about my size. And I gave it to him.
Wow.
Right there. And him and his wife got out the car, and he said, yeah, this is my wife, such and such. Missionary such and such, and they do. We just did this Haiti thing, and I said we did a Haiti thing. I said I need to connect you with
God.
Minister D from our church, and he said I'm gonna send you. I'm gonna Facebook you my information, me and my wife information, and we went to Haiti. So I said, well, we didn't quite go, but we sent stuff there Amen. Through a point of contact. He said, Amen. Man, I would love to connect with y'all church. We pray in the middle of this Exxon gas. They holding cars up. People ain't blowing out one horn. I'm out there with a tank top on because I took my
Paul
shirt
and
off.
Paul and Silas. Everybody listening.
And we prayed. And we prayed. And I tell you what, I felt, when I got in the car, I felt so much better.
Amen.
I felt so much better. And it wasn't no big thing that I was coming out singing the Mighty Clouds of Joy. I was doing something secular.
Amen.
And the Lord even took that and used it.
Amen.
Amen.
Won't he do it?
He will.
Amen.
And we're in verse 27. It says, and the keeper of the prison awakened from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. He knew what was in for him.
Yeah.
He was getting ready to take himself out. But Paul, I don't know how he saw that, but Paul called with a loud voice saying, do yourself no harm, for we are all here. The jailer saved him from a physical death. He was getting ready to kill himself. Paul, do yourself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light, ran in, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Somebody should shout.
Right there.
I don't care how you slice the dice or whatever. Out of all the things we may say in our life, what must I do to be saved?
Come on,
that's it right there.
Come on.
I don't care what you say. The most important thing to come out of anybody's mouth, what must I do to be saved? An assurance of eternal life. What must I do? That's the key word right there. As Christians, we want to get that unsaved person, that sinner, to say to us, what must I do to be saved? You had a question? Amen? That is powerful in itself. As kingdom builders, nothing should give us more great joy than somebody come up to us and say, what must I do to be saved? And we can give them the word. Now, let's go on, because it's not that difficult.
No, no, stay there. Because we ain't finished on that.
Talk to me. Got to talk fast.
He was asleep. He didn't hear.
The jailhouse rock, all that.
The prayer or the song.
Right.
It was the fact that the Spirit of the Lord still kept everybody
Amen.
There and safe. He came. His response was after Paul said, don't hurt yourself, man. And he's seeing everybody still there. Did he see him? I don't know. He asked for a light to see.
Right. Amen. That's
Look
right.
On. It's so, 'cause I don't like to read things too fast. I have to pause at each verse.
Amen.
And
he slept through all of that.
All of it. Every last bit.
Amen.
But his response was.
Well, when he woke up, though,
yeah.
The jailhouse was in chaos.
Yeah.
He.
And this is the second time God done something like this before. You remember the walls of Jericho?
Right.
He kept Rahab and her entire family.
Amen.
In all
That's
that
right.
shaking.
That's right.
And seeing this time, he did it again. And see, it keeps showing his mighty hand at work in this thing.
Amen. So he goes on to say, so they said, here's the response to the question.
Ooh, yeah.
Sir, what must I do to be saved?
Yes, sir.
Read this
So
one.
They said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He didn't give him a dissertation yeah. about that.
Uh-uh. Yeah, the whole thing.
He made it simple. Believe on the Lord Jesus. And you shall be saved.
Not only him, but go to the house people.
Yeah. Look,
because
there's
a fool in the house.
Yes, now.
He goes on to say, you will be saved, you.
Come on.
And your household.
Yes.
That's right.
Everybody.
Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house, and he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes.
Yeah.
Paul and Silas, and immediately he and his family were baptized.
Mm.
But again, because of their blessing, and that response on 31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you, they extended to, I'm going to extend it to your whole household.
Whole household.
That's right. That's right.
Extend it to the whole household. Not just you, but you and your household.
Yeah.
That's an awesome God.
Yes, he is. Thank you, Lord.
The same yesterday, today, and forevermore, tomorrow. That's the God that we serve.
Come on.
So what Paul and Silas experienced, some of us have may have experienced that on our own.
Mm.
Amen. I think we're about at the end.
We got two more verses. Uh-huh. And he took them same hour of the night and washed their stripes. Oh, he said immediately he and his family were baptized. Now when they had brought them into the house, he set food before them and rejoiced having believed in God with all his household. Mm. Celebration time.
Yeah.
Paul and Silas have gone through all of that. Now they're sitting at the jailer's house, sitting at his table. Not only did they have a spiritual revival, they had even a physical one. They took care of, Paul and Silas took care of their spiritual needs. Yeah. The ones that got saved took care of their physical needs. At the enemy's table. The board just said that God will make your enemies your footstool. But they weren't their footstool. God made their enemies their brothers. He could even make your enemies your brother or sister. That's an awesome God. And I know, I'm just, y'all would never do this. Dean Greg, I want some of them enemies to be my footstool. But we know God can make your enemies your brother and your sister. Yeah. To God be the glory. Because remember, our assignment is what? To enlarge the kingdom. Yeah. Not to make people our footstool. Amen. To God be the glory. Any questions? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for Bible study tonight, God. We thank you for your word, your scripture from in Acts 16, verses 16 through 40, God. So we just ask, God, that you would just allow those words, allow the conversation that we talked about, let it meditate in our hearts, God. Let us get that heart right, and God, everything else will fall in place. Father God, we ask that whatever was said or done was done decent and in order, God, and you get all the glory and honor. We claim victory over nothing other than what you have claimed victory over in this sanctuary today. Bless those that's in virtual, God. We ask that a word came forth that became a healing force for those who were in this conversation. We love you and honor you and glorify you, God. Now as we leave this place, God, but never your presence, give us safe travel and grace and mercy. Home, continue to lift up our pastor, his family, God. Keep us, God, until we assemble again. We ask these and all blessings in Jesus' name. We do pray, amen. To God be the glory. Good night.